if you start to build up resistance to antibiotics or allergies to some of them, so you limit the options we have to treat the infection, that's where the fulguration comes into play. Mm-hmm.
Philippe Zimmern specializes in female pelvic medicine and reconstructive surgery and is here to answer our questions on bladder fulguration today. Thank you so much for joining us.
Pleasure. Good to be with you.
We got a lot of questions, so I'm just going to jump straight in. First, it would be great if you could provide an overview on the history of bladder fulguration and its uses to give us some context for the procedure.
Sure. Yeah, bladder fulguration is really not something new at all, at least for urologists. We've been doing this for a long time for a variety of conditions, like bladder tumors in particular. Small tumors can be fulgurated. We've used it in other diseases like interstitial cystitis to fulgurate ulcers. So it's a very well-known procedure from a urologist standpoint. And to be honest with you, I've been at many meetings presenting data on fulguration. People said, oh, yes, I've done this all my life. And like, it's completely obvious to many of them. The problem is, where is the data? Mm-hmm. That's what I was, you know, confronted with at the time. I said, okay, did you publish your data? Oh, no, it's just something I do routinely. And then people would keep coming to my posters and presentation, just, you know, and I said to myself, fine, so it's been done for a long time. We've not killed anybody. It's been helping a lot of people according to all this impression from different physicians that it's mm-hmm. helping. It's probably time to put some science into it. And that's really what started my, you know, this current journey into this field of fulguration. But it's nothing that I've invented or discovered, or, you know, something that's been done. I'm just trying to understand really what it does to people and when it should be used.
Mm-hmm. We did get a lot of questions actually around whether research has been done. Can you give us a bit of some insight into where we're at with that?
Very, very small. I think I really started to try to publish my clinical data and get systematically rejected by people saying, but where is the proof that there are bacteria in the tissues and that you're really fixing the problem? Mm-hmm. I think people had recognized two sets of data by then. First, that antibiotics do not penetrate the biofilm, which is the environment in which bacteria hide out in tissues, whether it's the bladder or elsewhere in the body. Mm-hmm. And the second, really my kind of illuminating moment in life about this was when I read the work from Dr. Hultgren, Scott Hultgren, H-U-L-T-G-R-E-N, who worked in an animal model and tried to figure out, you know, what happened to the bacteria, how did they get incorporated in the tissues, how did they survive into these intracellular communities, and then how they basically flex out of that and then propagate the process of, you know, more infections from there on. Mm-hmm. And then the layer on surface sloughs off and it exposes layer deeper down, so bacteria can finally get deeper into the tissues. And so this in animal model made sense. And I said to myself at some point, my 75-year-old woman just told me she's not sexually active anymore. She just keeps getting bladder infections. I've studied her thoroughly. Her kidneys are fine. She has no problem to empty her bladder. She has no pelvic organ prolapse. Where is this infection coming from? I don't see any reflux on bladder x-ray. I don't see any bladder diverticulum. Where is the source of this infection? So I started to look at, you know, the bladder more carefully. And so you notice those inflammation areas in the trigone and other parts of the bladder. Mm-hmm. And that's why I started to wonder whether this was the site of infection. So there is some activation, the bacteria are produced, you get an active infection, you eliminate that with antibiotics, and then you wait a few weeks or a few days, and then it restarts all over again. So that chronicity and sometimes the same bacteria over and over, not always, but frequently, made me wonder if there was something else that we were missing. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, the good thing about our generation, we have better tools for cystoscopy. We have smaller telescope called flexible telescopes. They're much more comfortable than the one we used to use in the past, the rigid ones. And so I think when you look carefully at this area, when you use a technical retroflex where you advance the telescope, but it's flexible so you can look from the top down, mm-hmm. you see the base of the bladder, I think you start to pick up more where those chronic infections might reside. So it's obviously there's a visual training in recognizing these lesions, but certainly, you know, a lot of different things have converged at the same time in my mind. And so after that, I started to really work into asking my patient if I was going to cauterize these areas, would they mind if I took biopsies? And then I was blessed to work with a team here in Dallas at another institution doing research and gather that plus the help of other department like pathology and immunology and so on. We finally published, a very important paper in 2019 in the Journal of Molecular Biology, which really reported on our initial experience with this, tissues and biopsies. We had to use a very complex technology, which was made just for the bladder, called FISH, F-I-S-H, fluorescence in situ and hybridization. It's basically a technique that allows you to specifically stain different components of the bladder wall. So you can stain the nucleus of the cell, the surface of the urothelium, the bladder lining, and the bacteria. You can freeze them in color. So then we started to figure out, yes, they're really there, those tissues. Mm-hmm. I remember the excitement when we first looked at this first tissue set. We were right. That's where they are hiding. And that's probably the premise for why these women keep recurring. So that was all these things happened, it was in the last 10 years, to summarize that. So now we're just continuing all these projects and expanding them. And then the microbiome came as the next big concept about 4 or 5 years ago. The urine was not sterile, that there were bacteria there. There were good bacteria protecting a lot of women from infection probably, and some in whom we don't understand what happened. We just get, immune system gets overwhelmed, or we're dealing with very, unique bacteria, which may have been faced with antibiotics before, become quickly resistant. This is a whole other world of how they get in the bladder, move in the bladder, anchor themselves with pili or move with flagellas. It's another world of limited understanding. What's the role of what you eat and drink? What's the role of the urine pH? I mean, we can go on and on. There are a lot of questions, but no answers really there are definitive yet. But we're working on it. So.
Oh, that's good to hear. Definitely a lot of research needed. Is there a link between chronic UTI and bladder cancer?
Not that I know of.
Okay. Do you know if any research has been done into that?
No, I don't. They're really very distinct conditions. We do recommend biopsies if there's any question at the start of the process that we're dealing with, chronic inflammation versus cancer. Mm-hmm. We've not shown that, these women with chronic inflammation, even for decades and decades, turn into bladder cancer. So bladder cancer is very infrequent, fortunately, in women, predominantly in smokers, in older people. So there's one condition called carcinoma in situ, which is an early stage bladder cancer that should really be under consideration and lead to biopsies if the person suspects that.
Okay.
But the trigonitis, the inflammation of trigon, like we've just talked about today, this is so typical that, looking at all the biopsies I've done all these years, I've never had, that situation come up.
Okay, that's good to know.
And we're finding people now, and I would say, again, the rate of bladder cancer is just so low. Mm-hmm. I can't even cite one case of someone I did fulgurate long ago then had bladder cancer. I'm sure there will be some, physically there will be some. There's an age overlap, but not something that I'm concerned at all right now. Yes, maybe we should talk quickly about who should have that before we talk about the procedure.
There's many questions around that topic as well.
Yeah, I think
we can jump in there first.
Yeah, I think the indication is really something people ask me all the time. Right now, for me, as long as I can handle the process with, an antibiotic course, someone comes to me and says, I have 1 to 2 infections a year and they respond quickly to antibiotics, I'm not sure I would really do much more than that. And maybe things will change in the future because you could make the argument that over a lifetime, that's a lot of antibiotics treatment.
Sure.
It's kind of, frustrating to not know when the next infection will come. So I think it impacts people at different levels in life, sexual activity for sure, but maybe other things that they would like to do or travel, and they say, well, what if I have an infection and I'm somewhere far from my base? So, you know, I think it's still not a group that we should dismiss, but it's a group that is probably less in need of something, the fluctuation that we're going to talk about. If you start to build up resistance to antibiotics or allergies to some of them, so you limit the options we have to treat the infection as clinicians, then I'm starting to look more into, you know, can I correct the problem? And that's where the fluctuation comes into play. So we just spoke a minute ago. I really thoroughly researched if there's any other things to treat in that person, and I found a number of problems that have been overlooked before. Once the evaluation of the kidneys and bladder with imaging and examination, all this is done, and this is clean in my opinion, then I look at the scope as my next step. And it's not part of the current guidelines to do cystoscopy. I'm trying to push that notion, and a lot of people ask me, should there be scope? I think the answer is yes, by someone who understands what they're looking for, obviously. And then if I find those lesions, then the fluorescence would be my next offer, unless people are happy to continue with either, you know, daily prophylaxis or prophylaxis with intercourse. I mean, some people do fine. And until we have better tools to prevent infections, because we can talk about that as well, we're working on medications and intravesical treatment. So there may be a better option than having to undergo a procedure. So maybe our discussion of today, we'll look at that 10 years from now and say, oh my God, this is so antiquated, you know.
Potentially.
Look what we're doing now. We're just, I was listening, you know, this weekend to a presentation about vaccination, which is a large report for Spain. It looks very exciting. I just don't understand exactly how it works, but it looks at the, there may be a variety of new therapies that we will have at our disposal.
We hope so.
So fluorescence may not be needed in the future. If we can get these bacteria out of their entrenched, embedded position in the bladder without having to physically, you know, burn them off, which is so that's kind of the background of why the fluorescence. So the fluorescence itself, it's done under, you know, anesthesia. Typically light anesthesia. It's not like a major operation that you do. It's just done with a telescope. Outpatient, pretty much. The duration is around 30 minutes, 15 to 30 minutes for the most part. And when you look in the bladder, you use a little tiny cautery, which should look like a little fine tip electrode that's connected to very low current that basically is passed over the surface of these infection sites and just burn them off. At the recent meeting of the ICS, I presented a movie on that. I presented movies on what type of lesion we see in the bladder. So all those things could be made available to your audience.
Yeah, that would be helpful. We do get a lot of questions about what exactly you're looking for when you do a cystoscopy prior to fulguration. Is it just lesions or is it areas of inflammation as well?
All of the above. Yeah. Yeah. You can get just chronic, we call cystitis cystica, which are little cysts that form on the surface of the bladder. Some contain pus. You can clearly see the pus, you know, when you look carefully. Some have little tiny stones. Some are larger lesions. Some are just cluster to an area. And then we look at whether there's extension to the rest of the bladder. Obviously, the more a person has a lesion in the bladder, the harder it's going to be to win, so to speak, this fight, fulguration alone. So the more spread out the disease, the more problematic, in my view, it is to fix it like that.
Are there areas that you just cannot fulgurate in the bladder?
No, you can fulgurate every place that you can see. But when you have lesions that cover the whole bladder, we call that condition pan-PN cystitis, the whole bladder is involved. You obviously cannot cauterize the whole bladder. It's not possible. So you have, you know, a big problem on your hands when you have that. So I usually start, you know, to do majority of lesions I can see on the base, and then, you know, plan for repeat procedures, you know, in the future. And gradually, the volume of sites where bacteria can grow from goes down. And so in parallel, there's a tendency for reduction in infection rates, but not all the time.